A little boy sitting on a metal folding chair in what appears to be a Sunday school room. He could see that shepherd boy, his sling up in the air. He could feel that giant hit with a boom. In that room, I saw the Red Sea part, and two by two, animals get in the ark. And Mrs. King gently would say, the God of the past is still God today. So tell me again of the old, old stories. Tell me again of the faithful who walked in the lion's den and the fiery furnace of Noah and rainbows and donkeys that talked. I don't want to forget. So please tell me again. Sitting at a desk with a wooden chair in what appears to be a high school class. He can see a battlefield. There's giants everywhere. Saying the Bible is a thing of the past. In this new age you believe what you wanna believe, 'cause God is whatever you want it to be. And I can hear Mrs. Keene gently say, the God of the past is still God today. So tell me again of the old, old stories. Tell me again of the faithful who walked in the lion's den and the fiery furnace of Noah and rainbows and donkeys that talk. I don't wanna forget, so please tell me again. How the God of the ages turned history's pages and saw my need. Of the shepherds and wise men and the star that would lead them to the baby who was born, so that we tell me again of the gospel story. Tell me again how the whole world was lost, how the only begotten with grace so amazing gave up his life on an old rugged cross. I don't want to forget, so please tell me. Tell me again of the old, old stories. Tell me again of the faithful who walked, how the only begotten with grace so amazing gave up his life on an old rugged cross. I don't want to forget, so please tell me again.
Tell me again.
I don't want to forget, so please tell me.
This weekend, our kids, about 30 of them, are going to be presenting a musical, and it's part of our kids' choir camp program that Sue Helfrich ably directs, and her family joins in, and a lot of the moms of the church are involved in. It's pretty special. No, it's really special. And one of the very first songs is going to be a song about going back to creation and looking at some of the old stories of Scripture. And so Jan and I were thinking about that and how important that is for us to do from time to time, to think of our maybe conversion, our early years with Christ, and going back in the Old Testament to some of the stories of the Bible, like the the story of the Israelites fleeing from Egypt, which is a story that this church tells, and then thinking about how important some of the great stories of Scripture are in our lives and what they teach us and what they bring to us and what they bring to the table. So we came down here and just in the spirit of reminiscing to Helen Hazen Wyman Park, special park that our kids came to many, many times. We love bringing them here for creek walking and for crawdad fishing and for skipping stones. Blessings.
2 Timothy 2:8. Remember Jesus Christ. He came from David's family line. He was raised from the dead. That is my good news.
Welcome to Pilgrim and to Harper's Field Covered Bridge. We're going back in time a little bit today, kind of encouraged by the kids and the musical that's going to be happening this weekend, and then we'll be available on video sometime next week on our YouTube site. And their first song is Back to the Beginning and Remembering Creation and so forth. And for us, it's a time, I think, during quarantine and some of the frustrations now of the extended quarantine of going, all right, we've talked about peace and God being in control. We've talked about dealing with anxiety, and the importance of encouraging each other, all great biblical themes. Another biblical theme is to remember where we came from. And I think it's a good time for us to think about maybe our conversion, our early life with Christ, and then maybe look at some of the early stories of the Bible. So the kids are singing about creation, and Alice Sims did a fantastic job on Wednesday night of the 10 plagues. And so I thought maybe I'd pick some stories right around the time of the Israelites fleeing from Egypt and looking back. So here we see a covered bridge. And boy, it's probably going to be an Amish buggy that wanders through the bridge while we're here. Who knows? But we have so many neat things in our past and so much in our history, and it's so valuable. Savannah read, "Remember Jesus Christ." So even in the New Testament, there was that encouragement to remember back to the life of Christ. And of course, we do that again and again through so many different ways, like Christmas and Easter, and our preaching and teaching ministries and reading Scripture. Remember Jesus Christ. And it's pretty interesting. Even Jesus himself says, and I love this passage, it's from the Gospels, from the Gospel of John. I'm going to find it quickly and read it. It's just an amazing passage where Jesus says to some skeptics who know the Bible well but not accepted him, he says,
you diligently study the scriptures because you think that by them you possess eternal life. The scriptures talk about Christ and lead us to Christ, but the scriptures don't save us. Only Jesus and his grace saves us by grace through faith. You diligently study the scriptures because you think that by them you possess eternal life. These are the scriptures that testify about me, yet you refuse to come to me to have life. John chapter 5, verses 39 and 40. And that's given as a warning, but it could be also just presented this way. If you come to the scriptures and you read about me and come to me, you find life and eternal life and rest in me. And that's such a great message. You diligently study the scriptures because you think that by them you possess eternal life. These are the scriptures that testify about me, yet you refuse to come to me to have life. It's such a great warning to us to make sure that our faith is dependent and trusting in Jesus Christ, him alone, and him alone. Christ alone will stand. And so we remember back to Jesus, and then as believers, we remember way back, and I want to tell today some specific stories. But before I do that, I want to let you know that we are going to put out on YouTube the musical that the kids from the church are presenting this weekend at church. And so we're running the video sermon, but there's a different message for Sunday, and that's being given by our kids, about 25 of them, led by Sue Helfrich and her family and a number of our young parents from the church. Well, it's been a great week with them coming together and practicing. And that with practicing social distance as well. It's been a pretty amazing time. And God bless them as they share with us this Sunday. Ideally, that video will come out sometime next week. And then the Sunday, next Sunday for our message, we'll continue with remembering that. And also remembering, and the primary memory that we have is built on the Passover. And it's our communion service. Do this, says, in remembrance of me. And so we remember and we value our memories. Go back to the time of Abraham, the father of the nation of Israel and the father of our faith. Romans talks a lot about if we believe, we are children of Abraham. And so we proclaim this in the story of Abraham. Abraham was about 100 years old when things started happening to him. Well, a little bit younger, about 75 years old. His father had lived to be 200. So people were still living longer in those days. And Abraham is given a promise by God that he will become the father of the people of Israel, of a great nation that will bless the whole world. And Abraham's given that promise at the age of 75. And he's thinking about a land that he's going to possess. He ends up in Egypt for a while and has some interesting and exciting events there. He's married to a woman by the name of Sarai, and her name will be changed to Sarah. And they're given the belief that she'll have a son, and that son will be the beginning of this great nation. And through that son, all the people of the world will be blessed. But she's already about 100, and she's wondering, how could this happen? And how could God give a son to someone at her age? Only through a miracle. So there's enough distrust that, or just questions, that Abraham decides to have a child through a midwife, and goes to her, and they have the son Ishmael, and that's an interesting story. And Ishmael will be a disruptive, unsettled kind of son, not the son that God had planned. That son would come through Sarah, and that was a promise that was given to Abraham and Sarah. And so when Abraham is 100, just through a miracle of God, Sarah, much past childbearing age, gives birth to a son, and it's Isaac. And Isaac will bless the world, his children, ultimately. His great, 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 great grandchild, Jesus Christ, will bless the world. All the world will bless him. That's really an amazing story. Well, it didn't come easily. God wanted to test Abraham's faith, and so when Isaac was a bit older, God said to Abraham, let's take Isaac and bring him up the mountain. I'll provide the lamb and we'll sacrifice. And so Isaac and Abraham begin their hike up the mountain, and they're bringing wood. Isaac is carrying wood, and And he goes to Abraham, where's the lamb for the sacrifice? And Abraham's response is, God will provide the lamb. Remember that? That amazing story. They get to the place of the sacrifice, and Isaac begins to place the wood on the altar, and there's still no lamb. And then Abraham orders Isaac to lay down, and he's about to sacrifice his own son for the wood. And then God speaks and stops Abraham, and provides a ram and caught in the thicket for the sacrifice. And God is confident in Abraham's faith, building his family on Abraham and his people. What a story. It's pretty neat. Remember how Jesus said that scriptures speak of me? Think about Isaac as he carries the wood up the mountain for the sacrifice. One day another will come and carry wood up the hill, the wood of the cross. And Jesus will be the once for all sacrifice for the sin of the world. What a great picture. Isaac leads to Rebecca, which leads to their children, Jacob and Esau, and then a time of playing favorites. And right away, Jacob was the favorite. Esau was the firstborn, but he lost his firstborn status to Jacob as he sold his birthright, and it was through Jacob that the people of Israel would come. Jacob married two women. That's a challenge right there. Married two women. One was Leah, and the other was Leah's sister, Rachel. And Jacob got tricked into marrying Leah, had no interest in her, but he loved Rachel. And Walter Wangman talks about Leah as primarily being not Rachel. Not Leah herself, but not Rachel, because she wasn't Rachel. And Jacob wasn't happy. But because of Jacob's unhappiness, his disinterest in Leah, God opened Leah's womb, the Bible says. And Leah had 10 of his children, including the firstborn Reuben, and then a special son, Judah. And then, eventually, Rachel's womb was open, and she bore two sons, Joseph and Benjamin. And Joseph, of course, is critical to this story. But it would be Judah, ultimately, interestingly, the son of Leah, who would be the great-great-great-great-great-great-great-grandpa of Jesus. Jesus is the Lion of Judah, and it's the tribe of Judah that carries on throughout the history of the Old and into the New Testament. But Joseph was an important figure. Joseph was an important figure. But before we get to him, just a quick comment on Leah. God showed favor to Leah. And even though everyone around her was like, well, she's second best, or she's not really in the picture because Jacob loves Rachel so much, God saw, and I love this, and this is from the Children's Storybook Bible, God saw Leah as a princess. As a princess. He loved her in spite of everything that was around her. He loved her. And you know what? Jesus is a prince, the Prince of Peace. And he was hated and scorned and rebuked and mocked and you name it. Jesus experienced the kind of dislike that Leah would have. But God knew that he was the prince. And that we are as well. We're his princes and princesses. We're his sons and daughters. We're special, special people to God. He loves us very, very much. And the story of Leah reminds us of that. And that leads into the story of Joseph. 12 children, and Joseph was the favorite. Is it a good idea to have favorites as children? Parents to have favorite children? Of course not, but you know, we're human beings and we tend to have favorites, right? But we're not supposed to let anyone know, but it wasn't that way in the Old Testament times. And Jacob let everyone know that Joseph was his favorite. And Joseph kind of got under his brother's skin, and he was telling him stories from dreams he had of how they would all bow down to him, and he'd be the great and the mighty ruler, and they would be his subjects, and they didn't like Joseph. And then, to to top things off, Jacob gave Joseph a coat of many colors. This beautiful coat, only to Joseph. The coat of many colors. And that was it. They had it. They had had it. And so they decided to plot to take his life. They were going to take him out and throw him into a pit and let things happen, whatever would happen. But Judah and Reuben intervened, and they ended up selling Joseph to slave traders who brought Joseph into Egypt. And that's where the story of the Passover begins. That will be next Sunday's sermon. It will include in our children's time Alice and Ewald's stories of the Passover and the parting of the Red Sea. Two of the awesome stories to remember out of the Old Testament. And Joseph was sold into slavery, brought into Egypt, and there he met Potiphar and became a slave of Potiphar's, and had an interesting encounter with Potiphar's wife, but was faithful to God through all of the temptation and things that he endured. But he was placed in jail. While he was in jail, he told and answered dreams. And because of that, he was brought to the Pharaoh's court to interpret some dreams for the Pharaoh. And he was accurate, on target, and he was called by the Pharaoh to establish a system and to save grain for 7 years of drought, which Joseph was predicting would come. And through that, he rises to the very top of influence in the country of Egypt. Nation of Egypt. Very significant, very powerful man in that country. And one day, the family of Jacob, God's chosen people, went hungry. They came to Egypt to look for food. And so Joseph's brothers come as a group, one after another. They come to Joseph and ask if they can get food to bring home for their family. And Joseph recognizes them as his brothers, while they don't recognize him, in all of the sadness, and then the overwhelming emotion of Joseph to see his family again. So he treats them with, first of all, with trickery, but eventually with special, special honor and privilege. He gets to see his father again, and he's blessed by what happens and what takes place, and he's used in a mighty way. And that is how the people of Israel end up in Egypt and eventually become slaves, and a powerful, powerful nation of slaves within the country of Egypt. And that leads to the 10 plagues of Passover, the great, great stories that surround that we'll talk about next Sunday. But in the meantime, Joseph is such a figure, such a picture of Jesus Christ. Someone who was hated, sold into slavery even, was left for dead. But through all these awful things that take place, he becomes a savior for his people. And we think about Jesus, and we like to think Jesus should have had such a nice life. But Jesus didn't. He was challenged from day one, from the beginning, by the Pharisees and the Sadducees. People that distrusted him and knew he was powerful, and they were afraid of him. And so Jesus experienced all of that, and finally he was persecuted, killed, sacrificed. But we discover for our sin and for the sin of the world, so he could be the Savior. Just like Joseph rescued his people, Jesus comes to rescue us. And then we're invited to believe in that and simply to have faith, to love him and trust him. Remember Jesus Christ. Remember Jesus Christ, the descendant of David, raised from the dead. This is the gospel. Believe.
Great is thy faithfulness, O God, my Father. There is no shadow of turning with thee. Thou changest not thy compassions, they fail not. As thou hast been, thou forever wilt be. Great is thy faithfulness.
Tell me again of the gospel story. Tell me again how the whole world was lost. How the only begotten, with grace so amazing, gave up his life on an old rugged cross. I don't want to forget. So please tell me, tell me. Tell me again.